How are we doing today? Welcome back, one and all. Let me just bring that down really quickly. There we go. Awesome. Well, welcome back, everyone, to yet another season of Inside Fanatics Brush podcast. Season 2022. Happy New Year, everyone. Hope you had great festivities, that you celebrated a lot, and that you're ready for this new season of the LEC. Oh boy, what a season it's going to be. A little pre-season show, as we like to do it usually, for a quick overview of what happened during the off-season. The new teams, new orgs. We have BDS joining the LEC, taking over Schalke. And what we should be expecting, not only for the LEC rankings, but also for Fnatic, because that's why we're here. We're here to talk about Fnatic as well. So, as you can see on our little schedule for today, there you go, we will be checking the new LEC teams, the roster shuffles that happened, and do a little quick ranking on what I think will be the best teams and those that, you know, have a chance of getting to the top. Then we'll be looking at Fnatic 2022 and the incredible roster that they've managed to put together, see what their potential and what expectations can be. Oh, just realized that I didn't write expectations properly. Let me change that real quick. Expectations. There we go. Much better. And of course, our usual week one predictions at the end of the show. Cool. For anyone joining who might be new to the show, my name is Matt Scott. This is my second season of doing Inside Fnatic's Brush. I've been a Fnatic fan since 2013, roughly. Had the chance to go to a few live events and meet some of the players. Always been big fan of the organization ever since, and, you know, followed them through thick and thin. So that's pretty much about me. You can find me on Discord, on the official Fnatic, or you can find me on Twitter on @MattScott_, or on the other one, don't know which one, IFB Podcast, which is the official podcast Twitter. Who do we have here? We have some people joining us just in time before I start the rankings. Kuni Julio and Irisu, how are you doing, guys? Welcome. Thank you for joining. Esports Boomer, that is me. Season number two. Let's go for season number two. And what a season it's gonna be, guys. Because this is what we're looking at today. This big bundle of teams that we have might find a new logo, which is the BDS logo. So BDS is a Swiss team that initially had an LFL team, so French ERL team, but who bought the Schalke spot last season, so they'll be replacing them. And they've actually just revamped their logos, so there's a lot of fresh stuff coming their way. Other than that, in terms of our teams, nothing much really happened, except some, let's say, surprising movement from a lot of teams. Not sure where to start. Maybe I guess the biggest ones and some of the most controversial ones came from both G2 and Fnatic. I think those are the ones that made the most headlines this season. Starting with G2, where obviously, after failing to qualify for Worlds last year, have decided to do a big fat revamp and lose three of their members. One of them being Reckless, who had just joined the organization. So that was quite the move here. Reckless now in LFL, part of the K Corp team, but brought in some fresh talents. Probably the first time they've had rookies since G2 existed, with Flekkit in the ADC role. Now I've seen some people saying Targamas, their support, qu being qualified as a rookie, which isn't the case. I'm pretty sure Targamas played under Misfits a few seasons before, or some other team, but he's been around. He's been around for sure. And for their top lane, they've taken Broken Blade. He's had a decent season with Schalke. On the other side, Fnatic also losing three members now. Obviously, after the whole drama situation that happened, but first we lost Wippo, who was ending his contract with Fnatic, and it was already strongly rumored that he wanted to change, went over to Team Liquid, and we've had both Adam and Niski leave the team as well. Actually, scratched that. Niski is still with Fnatic, but no longer on the active roster. Adam now has joined BDS with some of his former teammates from K Corp, and instead, we've managed to get Razor from Misfits, who had a very, very good season, despite playing with, I'd say mid-tier players. And on top of that, we have Wunder, of all people, being part of Fnatic, which feels some sort of Twilight Zone situation. If you had told me, I don't know, maybe back in, let's say 2018, that Wunder would be part of Fnatic in the future, I'd have probably called you a big liar and told you to leave me alone, because Wunder was definitely very harsh towards Fnatic, and I personally wasn't a fan of it, but people come and go, and it is what it is. And now he's part of Fnatic, and despite obviously a very complicated season last year, we'll see what he's able to do in a different environment, different teammates. It's been a good, what, 3 to 4 years that he's been part of the G2 roster. So sometime, big change can bring back some of the previous levels that some players have had. And I think for me, the biggest surprise, obviously, when Niski was said to originally go back to Cloud9, and after the deal fell through, we didn't really know what type of mid laner we were going to get, and we somehow got our hands on Humanoid, of all people. Like, we're getting one of the best mid laners, two-time LEC winner from previous season, into our roster. I think that's an amazing, amazing gift. I feel like, personally, when I look at Humanoid as someone who's been constantly improving, season after season. At the time when he joined the LEC, it was part of like the trifecta of mid laner rookies, where it's like Humanoid, Nemesis, and I believe Larson as well. And I remember a lot of people already at the time saying that Humanoid was like the best of these three rookie mid laners, and he's definitely the one who has the best growth out of those three of them. So I'm hoping that this continues on with Fnatic, and that he gets to lift another trophy for us. So that would be optimal, obviously. What are you guys saying? Fnatic Wunder has to be one of the most blessed and cursed things to happen in the LEC in the last few years. I definitely laughed when Oh, first when it was confirmed, but second when it was rumored. You know, it's you have to realize that obviously we had a lot of hope behind Adam. He had a pretty decent split for a rookie who just, you know, had constant growth throughout his early career. Obviously, Worlds happened what happened there, and he did struggle against the international top laners, but for a first time rookie, you have to consider that, you know, it's quite impressive what he's been able to do so far. So obviously expecting him to continue on that trend with Fnatic this season. All the drama happened, whatever. Then it's like, what happens then? Like, what top laners are available? And obviously, there's the whole Perks Alfari thing that fell through. And now you're, if without necessarily looking into the ERLs, what's available so far? And then when they started talking about Wunder and everything, it was like, is that actually happening? Is this a timeline we live in? But it is. And, you know, I think if you look at his career, especially in G2, there's just a 2021 that really stands out as really a poor season from him. Otherwise, he's always been one of the top laners for EU, even, you know, able to smash international competition. So I think there's a bit of a bet that's done behind here of him coming back at the top of the competition. Where's the mascot tweet about? There's nothing about this. This does not exist. This does not exist. All right, guys. Let's jump right into the rankings. I'm just gonna make sure I have the right tab here. When I go in there, oop. Is this working properly? It is. Cool. So I know I'm not necessarily being very original, but I had to go with this the little tier list maker thingy, just to change it a bit for once. I've put it into five categories. So at the top, those that I expect to be the, you know, biggest potential LEC winners. Second are the strong competitors, so people who can potentially win it, and who are, I think, you know, gonna trail right behind and have potential to grow. Third place is the playoff makers, is the people who are gonna be fighting maybe for that fourth, fifth, sixth place, but won't necessarily go further in the playoffs. The fourth part, teams who just kind of lacked ambition in going into the spring split. Didn't necessarily field some exciting rosters, in my opinion. And the fifth one is just why? Why? What did you do? Like, what's the plan here? I don't know what you're trying to do. You know, so pretty straightforward. Fnatic S++++ tier, trust me. Well, we'll get there. It's the third pick. So, you know, starting with Astralis. So Astralis only changed two players. They changed their mid laner with Dazhor, who was previously of Fnatic Rising, who replaced Febiven kind of middle of the summer split, I believe. He did manage to go to finals to UM against K Corp, but you know, in my opinion, he did rather well. I just think maybe the jump to LEC is too soon. You know, so we'll see. His teammates obviously praise him quite a bit, so I want him to do well. The ADC has been changed to Kobe. I don't know. Kobe for me wasn't that exciting on Misfits. He hasn't been exciting ever since he came back from NA. I believe there's a bigger pool in ERL. If you're really going to dive into rookies and try to maybe revamp your brand with, you know, some strong players, try to look into that instead of, you know, getting a guy like Kobe who, I don't know, for me it's just that it's not it, really. And obviously Zanzara, White Knight, and Promiscue still part of the team. You know, White Knight wasn't too bad. Zanzara, I think people remember him more for his memes than really his gameplay. And then Promiscue is like a discount version of Hillisang. Like, he's just full on int, and eventually he'll have these, you know, really good plays or genius moments, but it just doesn't have enough things for him to, you know, people constantly make fun of him. You know, whatever, he has really some very amazing plays sometimes, but they're just so rare that, you know, it's not enough for him to be considered seriously as, you know, an effective support. So, you know, for me, Astralis just goes straight into here. It's, I don't know what they're trying with this roster. It's more than lacking ambition. It's there doesn't seem to be a direction in there. It's just, you know, taking a rookie that hasn't confirmed anything and taking an ADC who's, you know, middle to bottom tier, in my opinion. I don't know. Moving on to XL. XL had an interesting summer split, to say the least, with Markkun and Advien coming in, who had a rather good showing at the beginning and then kind of stabilized towards the end. Unfortunately, not allowing XL to finally qualify for playoffs for once in their lives. But, you know, they've made a few modifications. One of them changing their top laners with Finn coming from the hellhole that is CLG. I mean, Finn is an okay top laner, but if you look at the pool of top laners that there are in EU currently, I don't think he's able to match. I think he can stabilize the game. Other than that, I don't think he has any carry potential, and he makes a lot of mistakes still to this day. And the other change was, wait, I think that was the only change, wasn't it? Because they kept Markkun, they kept Nuke Duck, Patrick resigned, and that. So they only made one change, right? If I'm not mistaken. But so, in that sense, you know, it's interesting, right? Because obviously they're probably going to keep on that synergy going forward and just having to include Finn. With that said, is Finn really going to be the game changer for them? You know, is that what's going to make the difference between making playoffs and not making playoffs? I personally don't think so. I'm not sure how much Markkun and Advien are able to keep bringing to the team so that they actually make a change, especially when you consider the other teams that are involved in there. So, yeah, I think for me, it's just going to be in this section where it lacks ambition. It's, you know, you want to make one small change, but that change doesn't really add more to your team in terms of what it can do to qualify for playoffs. At least that's my opinion. Let's see, you guys left a few comments. Can't fill a plane if you don't have one. Astralis to the stars, baby. Astralis went to occasional pop-off players to a bunch of players who are more consistent but with lower high points. Yeah, basically a consistent team, but they don't really have a win condition. I think they made their moves for this year halfway through last summer, hoping the trajectory of Markkun and Advien continues. Patrick and Yurikdog were consistent enough to stay. Finn, I mean, it's definitely a slight upgrade, but it's not enough, in my opinion. Again, like, this is purely an LEC fan viewer giving his opinion, so like, I don't have enough analysis here, but for me, it's, you know, you've been missing out on playoffs for so much, try to get an exciting player. For me, Finn is not it. It's someone who's stable. Again, Patrick and Young Duck, I'll agree that you know, they were this. That's the thing. It's like, it's consistency. It's good, but you need something more than just consistency to get you to the next step. So, I don't know. Maybe they'll make playoffs. I think there's probably stronger teams or teams that have better long-term development, we'll say, to be on that top six rank. Right. Finn isn't a great player, but he is better than Kreis. I mean, for sure. It's probably either get Finn or bet on the lesser-known rookie for XL. I don't know any big FA top laners. Well, I mean, from the top of my mind, I can think of it. I mean, obviously not including availability and stuff like this, but I know Aggressivo was highly rated. I believe he's in BDS LFL team. Who else? Who else? I think wasn't Shigenda available? I don't know. I think Shigenda just unfortunately was part of Vitality, which isn't a great org, but I don't know. Trying to think quickly here, but not too sure. I mean, Cabochard maybe, but he probably wanted to in KC. I don't know. I don't know. Yeah, no, his time on Vitality wasn't great either, but I don't know. I'm sure there were better people available. In any case, on to our next pick. Well, I think we know where this one is going. You know, accuse me of bias already. No, okay, let's be very serious here. I think for the first time in a maybe very, very long time, does Fnatic come as one of the favorites at the beginning of a season and has so much star power from the get-go? Probably since the X-Pekka era, right? Because if you look at it, 2015, we have a bunch of rookies with an unknown top laner. Steelback coming in, Febiven coming from H2K, who I believe was H2K was Academy still at the time. So bunch of rookies, stuff like this, unknown players for most of them. 2016, we have obviously Gamsu, who wasn't necessarily that exciting. Only Spirit was, you know, awesome, and then we had Febiven and Reckless, but with Klai as our support, who again was some unknown player, so you know, not a lot of necessarily star power, if only just coming from the previous season, but not enough. 2017, we have this strange mid laner known as Caps coming in. We take what's his name? I can't, the guy with the glasses, the support. I am completely blanking right now. There's a coach now, obviously, who was the coach for Misfits last season. Jesus, thank you. And wait. Yeah, so obviously there's the return of Soaz, and we have Amazing. But apart from that, you know, it's not just like full star power on the roster. Obviously Broxah comes in the middle. Next season kinda the same with Bwipo coming in and Hillisang. So Hillisang was obviously pretty popular in Unicorns of Love, but hadn't necessarily managed to lift a trophy. And then we just, you know, change things here and there. Nemesis, self-made. Then the big shuffle last year with Niski losing Reckless for upsets. So, some big names, but not really like big full star power of like people who have achieved or been necessarily, outstanding in their own role. And this season, without being a necessarily like superstar slash all-star team, it's just very big names of people who have achieved stuff. Wunder, MSI winner, multiple LEC winner. Obviously, you have Humanoid, just comes out of an amazing season, went to MSI, took Damwon one to five games. Razorc, who, despite being in Misfits with a lot of rookies around him, managed to really stand out at one of the top junglers last season and big MVP candidate. And obviously we have our bot lane, who's touted by many to be the best bot lane in the West. So there's just so much firepower in there, and with things that can really work together well. For me, obviously, probably the biggest gamble is on a return in form for Wunder. Again, if we just look at his career in total, this last season just really stands out. But you have to consider that he's been one of the best top laners in the West for a very, very long time, that he's challenged the Korean top laners, and he's won an international trophy. So is the change of environment, setup and everything gonna help him get back to the? I personally hope so. We've seen how versatile he can be for his team as well, playing some uncanny picks. So yeah, it's just how well this team meshes together. But if it works really well and they find their groove, for me, they're definitely top team, one of the teams to win the LEC for sure, for sure. La Formula, yeah, La Formula. It's Dardo has done some great work on that one. There's definitely a vision from Dardo for Fnatic, and for me, winning the LEC will be sort of the accomplishment of that vision for him. It's like he had a very, very rough start when he started, and everybody was just flaming him. When Reckless left, it was just like he is the worst, he needs to leave. And it's like he had to go through all of that rubble first before being able to put his print on what his objective was. And the team he's given us today, I think, is a good representation of what he's been trying to do in the end. So definitely some great work and some great expectations for this team as well. It's also fun that all players this year could end up keeping our aggressive. That's a very good point, actually, in terms of aggression, that they're definitely in that scope, in that style. One thing I also wanted to add is Humanoid. With getting Humanoid, we get someone who's able to really clutch it up. And I think that's a type of player that we've kind of missed in Fnatic for the past few years. We've had stable players, consistent players, but not necessarily a lot of players who can bring us back from the brink of death, except if you maybe count Reckless once he's hit that 300 CS cap and then he suddenly switches on. But there's even like I wonder, in some situations can be considered a clutch player in my opinion. So yeah. That's I think it's going to be a super exciting season for sure. Moving on to G2, our good old rivals. For me, I'm going to put them for now as strong competitors. I think people are kind of underestimating the potential of this team because they just didn't make Worlds last season. I see a lot of people trash talking Broken Blade. Not too sure why. For me, I think he's an exceptional player who's insanely good mechanically and who's was kind of a standout on Schalke. In terms of like more global play, I don't know if he has as much impact maybe, but in terms of laning, like I remember when he used to face Wipo when he was still part of TSM, he was doing really well against Wipo. You know, even though he got soloed, he was really, you know, trading really well with him. So I definitely wouldn't sleep on Broken Blade. Targamas, who has been part of Fnatic Rising before, I think is an exceptional support. And he, if he's the one that's gonna be shot calling and you know, driving the team a bit more around their execution, it'll be, I think, a crucial element since the departure of Perks, where I feel they kind of missed someone to sort of drive the team during their game. I think the only question mark for me that's preventing me maybe from putting them on the LEC winners bracket is Flakid. I don't know much about him. I've never heard much from him last season. You know, I've heard more about, you know, players like Unforgiven, Dexpectra, Ex-Matty, for instance. Even Bean, obviously. Love Bean. Instead of him. So, not too sure what he's capable of doing. I'm gonna trust the team on their selection on that one. And, you know, I think obviously they will need some time to grow, but I think there's a chance that this kind of new wind makes G2 really, you know, strong again, and maybe brings back Jankos and Caps to their previous levels. So yeah, that's pretty much it for this. Let me see. It was a doubter of Dardo, but he was the answer to the blind. He is the light. Absolutely, absolutely. I think people being down on G2 mostly has to do with them going from top one players in every role to rookies and a Schalke player. They obviously have great players now, but a weird counter. I mean, that's the thing, right? It's that they have a rookie for the first time since probably the existence of the org. So that'll be interesting, you know, how they finally fitting a rookie within their team. But they definitely, you know, have two strong additions with Broken Blade and Targamas. So we'll see. We'll see how they fit together. Cool. Moving on to Mad Lions. Mad Lions, who have lost two of their members, surprisingly, Humanoid and Karzy, and replaced them with two rookies, which I think is interesting, exciting as well. They got Reeker, who was one of, I think, one of the most praised ERL mid laners last season, and I think was a strong prospect for a lot of teams. And they got Unforgiven in as the ADC, who as well was considered one of the top ADCs in ERL. So definitely a team to look forward to. They obviously still have players like Kaiser, Illyria, and Armut, who, you know, are top two, top three in their respective role. I think Illyria definitely is still up there. Armut has shown that, you know, he's capable of really challenging some of the established LEC top laners and having his pocket picks like the Gnar or the Wukong. And Kaiser, who has been one of the best supports for the past few years, and we'll see obviously how they mesh again together. I think they could surprise again and potentially could be, you know, top three you know, of the winner. Maybe they win it all. Who knows? We will have to see how these rookies fit in into an LEC structure this time. But I think Mad Lions made some really good moves this season, and you know, managed to recover from losing some great players, especially like Humanoids. You know, for me, it's exciting to, you know, when you lose a big player that you replace him with an upcoming rookie. You know, you're kind of ensuring yourself of the future of the team by doing this. So it's cool. It's cool. I think Mad Lions definitely made some good moves here. My coaching rookies, which has worked really well for two seasons. Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point. Mike's very good coach. Mad Lions, great organization, a lot of resources. So we'll see. They're gonna be wanting to fight for their trophy. Obviously, they want to stay up there. So we'll see how it works out. Cool. Moving on to Misfits. Misfits. I'm not too sure where to put them. Kind of want to put them here-ish. So let's see. They have Herit, Schlatan, Vitio, Neon, and I forgot his name. It's like a new support I never heard of. Yeah, I'm blanking. Versa, thank you. So Schlatan has been known for a few years now to be a very good jungler. And it's cool that he finally gets promoted. Neon, I mean, again, I think he's an okay ADC. He has his moments, but from what I've heard, apparently he's a bit difficult to work with. So I don't know how that plays within Misfits. And then Mercer, I can't judge the guy. It's the first time I've heard of him. I'm not too sure where he's from, which team he was before. I didn't necessarily do my research on this. You'll have to forgive me for that. But yeah, it's hard for me to say. I think there's probably potential they make playoffs, but yeah, there's no like real power behind it, because like it depends how Schlatan and Vitio work. But for me, Vitio was able to shine because Razork was doing just so much work for Misfits and was giving him all that space, all those occasions for him to shine. I don't know how Schlatan obviously works in there. Herit was a good top laner in my opinion. We'll have to see how it works after his rookie year, obviously. But yeah, the bot lane for me is, I don't know. There's Neon, who, yeah, it's kind of middle of the pack ADC, and Mercer, which I know nothing of. So Misfits versus XL for last playoff spot, potentially could happen. But yeah, I'm just gonna put them as lack of ambition, but I'll be maybe looking at them specifically to see what their real potential is, because so far I don't know. I'm not convinced. Moving on to Rogue. Now Rogue. Rogue man. It's either there or there. I'm gonna put them there because it's just so weird. So they lost Inspired, who's one of the best junglers last season, MVP winner, and Han Sama, which is probably one of their best players as well. So in my opinion, they've lost probably their top two players. In my opinion. Han Sama, which was top two ADCs, easily. This guy was absolutely fucking insane. He was carrying Rogue on his shoulders in some games. Like, it sucks that he's in NA, but if he plays in NA the way he played last season, he is going to absolutely roll over any bot lane. Like, he's going to get 5 kills at 3 minutes. Okay, maybe I'm exaggerating, but you know what I mean. This guy is going to absolutely destroy people. But they've replaced Han Sama with Comp, which kind of got, you know, kicked from Vitality and replaced by Crownshot without great results. Comp was, I mean, he was okay. I think he's gone into the time chamber to improve, and you know, he's worked a lot on himself, and but I think it's still a massive downgrade compared to Han Sama. And of all people, Malrang to replace him. So first of all, why are you going to Korea? No, actually, okay, no. I can understand getting an import if you want to. Sure. But of all the imports you get Malrang, dude. I don't know, maybe I don't watch LCK enough, but for me, Malrang was like, you know, second choice already over there. So it's, I don't know, they just, their replacements are just not exciting enough for me to consider them as actual competitors. So for me, I'm just gonna leave them, you know, like, they're gonna make playoffs, but I don't expect them to be as dominant as they were last season, for sure. They've just lost so much of their carry potential and the difference makers in the team. I feel like they've really, really hit the pavement hard on that one. So it's gonna be difficult for them, for sure. Rogue had a massacre on their off season, lost too much, yeah. Rogue depends on Marang's communication and if Odo and Larson will pop off. That's the thing, it's like now the carries have been transitioned. Will be good to see Comp on a more competitive team as well. I guess so. Marang's kinda cracked. I mean, we'll see. I mean, obviously, you know, I'm sure he's good, but there's strong jungle competition as well in Europe, so I don't expect him to be on top of the ones that we have currently. I mean, solo queue monster, that's good for him, but how does that translate in pro play, you know? So we'll see. Moving on to SK. SK is like, I'm just gonna put it back there. SK, so they kept Jennax, who for me is pretty decent top laner. They got Gilius, got Certus, and they kept their bot lane. Jeju was actually fine. And I think there's more space for him to evolve this year, but I don't think he was that awful. And I think he was the best when Treats was a support. And Treats now is back as a support. And in my personal opinion, I think Treats was the backbone of SK, who was the ones who managed to work so well. And when the off season started, I personally thought that G2 should go for traits, because if you're looking for a shot caller, for someone who's able to, you know, drive your team to from point A to point B, I think traits is the right guy to do it. I also remember that Reckless wanted to play with traits at some point, so I think there's a lot of value in this player. Now, few things. Traits and Gilius on the same team might clash, because Gilius is a real, really big voice. So how does that work between them? I think Gilius is a great sort of, how would I call this? Sort of patching player. As in you put a band-aid, you know, on a team before you find something that's a bit better, a bit more potential. And Gilius did some great stuff for Schalke, I'm not saying, but you know, he gets, I feel like he can easily be exploited. But I think he's a great teammate, most of all. And Certus, again, like I've heard of him, but I haven't seen enough from him to make a decision. So really, it's between, you know, what I consider traits to be able to bring and the rest of the team. I'm just gonna put it here. I'm sorry, it's just, yeah, I don't know. Oh, I guess we'll have to see. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I should put them here. No idea. I'll just put them here for now. Moving on to BDS. BDS, aka K-Corp 2.0. No, kidding. BDS, new team in the LEC this season, who have a roster that has a lot of previous players from K-Corp. So obviously they have Adam, who transferred from Fnatic to them. They brought in Synchroff. So Synchroff is back in the LEC. He was in the EULCS a few seasons before, I believe, in Misfits, if I'm not mistaken. Nuclear Int, who transferred from Schalke, which I think was probably one of the, you know, standout players on the summer split for Schalke. I think he's a decent mid laner. They got X-Matty. Now I'm excited to see X-Matty. X-Matty was part of Fnatic Rising for many years, and he's really, really good. I'm expecting him to definitely, I don't know if I should necessarily say top 3 ADCs next season, but I think he's gonna be up there, and I hope he's gonna be, because I really rate him. And I think he's an amazing player. And they have Limit as their support, who, you know, I think he has a very good Alistar. But beyond that, I'm not too sure about his potential. So for me, I believe they can be playoff makers, in the sense that there is some potential. I think they're probably going to start rather well, because they have that built-in synergy, because majority of them have already played together, so that will probably be in their favor. But I think as the season goes on, the discrepancy in potential will catch up to them, and the teams that have obviously better player or maybe more seasoned players will eventually take over. So I think they'll probably, you know, get fifth or sixth, in my opinion. And you know, they'll probably be spoilers for some, you know, top teams. Maybe they'll manage to grab a win here and there, but yeah, there's a lot of rookie slash mid low tier talent. Like Sinkroff last time he was in the ULCS, he was not good. He was not good. He improved since, but that's in ERL. How is he able to fare in LEC, you know, where again the competition, especially for jungle, is quite stacked. But yeah, moving on to which I think is one of the most surprising roster shuffles in many years is Vitality, and Vitality is going to join Fnatic here on that one, where they have what you could call an all-star roster. Pretty crazy what they've been able to assemble. Bringing back Perks and Alfari from NA. Selfmade, who's constantly, you know, been improving and being one of the top junglers now in LEC, and you know, is a big name in that role now in Europe. Karzi from Mad Lions, I think is interesting. Definitely very good, but we'll have to see how much impact he can have, especially with Labrov, who I think Labrov has a lot of potential, but just kind of misses out on the execution, and in the end, just isn't able to be to the level where he could be. So I don't know, maybe playing with higher tiered players around him will change that and he'll have a bigger impact. I just remember his fresh plays, which always have been very impressive. But other than that, you know, definitely a very, very scary team. Fnatic Vitality on Saturday, so we already have a big, big show match on the first week. So we'll have to see, you know, it'll kind of give us a gauge on, you know, where these teams are right now and how far they can go potentially. But yeah, that's gonna be my sort of tier list for the moment. I don't know what you guys think. If you agree, you disagree. If there's any teams you would change, you would put higher, you would put lower. If I'm being absolutely crazy or stupid with my expectations, but yeah, I think this is kind of what we're looking at right now. We'll have to see what Misfits and SK are able to do and see if they move up and down in this ranking. But yeah, just to show you what I would expect actually from the final ranking at the end of the regular season, this is what it would look like for me, basically. With I would well, you're probably gonna say bias, but I think Fnatic has potential to be first because Vitality has a lot of strong personalities. You have Perks, Selfmade, Alfari, so you know if they start losing, how are they able to manage this? So, you know, more risks potential within them. I think Mad Lions has more exciting new players, so I kind of rate them over G2, which I think might not have a good spring, might have a better summer. BDS, I think people are kind of sleeping on BDS, possibly because of, you know, Adam and his shenanigans, but I don't know. I see some potential within this team, so we'll see what they're able to do with Rogue just getting that final spot. Misfits, SKXL, just kind of in the same bundle. I've put Misfits above because I don't know. People seem to be rating Schlatten quite a bit, so we'll see. And obviously, Astralis last. Zanzara with Trundle will beat BDS. Maybe. Maybe. If it doesn't get banned, you know. BDS playoffs, I don't know. But no. I believe BDS is able to make playoffs. They might not necessarily go very far in playoffs, but I think there's a lot of potential within these players, and they'll have time to grow without throughout the split. I think this is how their season's gonna go. It's gonna go like this. So they're gonna probably start strong because their synergy is here. Then there's going to be a bit of a catch up by other teams, so they're going to struggle. And then at the end, when they finally work back a bit together again, they'll be able to just qualify. So maybe you can change Rogue and BDS, but that's my predictions, at least. So, well, we'll have to see if I'm right or if I'm wrong. At least the one thing we know I'm right is Fnatic first, obviously. No doubt about that one. Speaking of which, Fnatic 2022. Guys, what a roster we have this season, right? Amazing. Yeah, just obviously going back over what's been said previously, but quite an amazing and intense roster we have here. A lot of talent, top talent in each of their respective roles, and top two, maybe top three if you want to say, in each of their roles. Obviously, seeing Wunder in the Fnatic jersey is some sort of Twilight Zone shit, but I'll be Wunder's biggest fan if he just stomps and brings us back to the top and makes us lift an LEC trophy. You can guarantee that. And you know what? Okay. For the few viewers who are here, maybe the people who will watch on YouTube or on the Twitch VODs afterwards, let's have a little deal between us, okay? If Fnatic manages to win Spring Split of LEC, and Wunder really comes back into form, really plays really well and isn't just getting carried by his team, I will get a Fnatic jersey with Wunder on the back. All right? All right. That's gonna be the deal. That's gonna be the deal. If you guys are okay with that. I'll get Wunder on the back. So the deal has to be win LEC. And Wunder obviously has to be a good, not necessarily a standout player, but basically not getting carried, not be 0-10 every game. So cringe. It's not cringe. Listen, it's a deal. People know my past with Wunder. They know how I feel about him, and how I'm kind of forced to like him now. He's part of Fnatic. Mascot biggest fan of Wunder. I will be within those conditions. So, it's on video. It's out there for people to know. So, if it happens and we win, you can tag me on Twitter, at Matt Scott. Oops, over there. Underscore, on the IFB podcast, to remind me. And obviously, if it happens, I will post proof on Twitter online. But with that said, I'm super excited about this team. I really hope. So my two biggest fears, I think, are one of them, Wunder not necessarily getting back to form, so still struggling and being kind of this bet gone wrong, basically. And the other thing is how well they're gonna mesh together. Those are all confirmed players. There's no rookies whatsoever, so they all have their way of playing. So I feel there's gonna be a lot of space to adapt. And I'm just really curious on how they're gonna mesh well together. So I think that's gonna be one of the biggest challenges. Obviously, for the first few games, I'm not expecting anything to be perfect, especially as the teams will be playing from home. So that means Berlin internet, all sorts of stuff. But I think what's important to consider here is that there's a lot of expectations behind, such a roster, obviously. I think the fans will be pretty much expecting nothing else but to win the LEC. And if there's anything but, I don't know, let's say on a very large scale, top two. I think there'll be a lot of questions and obviously some dissatisfaction, probably a lot of toxicity as we're used to, but I think with these type of players, their personality and their play style, I think there's a lot of confidence to be had in the potential and what we can achieve. Not saying we're necessarily gonna, win both LECs, MSI Worlds, this is the year, but I do believe we can at least win one split, and if not with this roster, then which one? I think we've gone, full deck on the table, all in. The chips are in there, and we have to give it our all. I think a lot of hungry players who want to prove themselves, and we just have what it takes, in my opinion, to get there. So yeah, I see a lot of people saying that they have faith that we have this. Let's do it. 2022, baby. Fnatic, it's gonna happen. We have to do it for the boys, for Dardo, for La Formula. This is it. But yeah, that's pretty much what I have to say. It's strong potential, big expectations. Let us lift the trophy again, boys. Please, please. It's been too long. And this is one of the most exciting rosters we've ever had. And if we win, there's the Wunder jersey that will be happening, guys. Now, that's, what will be the biggest surprise of 2022? Wunder wearing a Fnatic jersey or Matt Scott wearing a Wunder jersey? Think about that. Exactly. Exactly. But anyways, both, I guess so. I guess so. But yeah. All right, guys. Let's just move on to the predictions to round this up, this first podcast of the season. Some predictions, day one predictions. Things are pretty straightforward. Oh yeah, so qu quick thing. I'm still, so for this prediction, I'm still using the prediction sheets from the Fnatic Discord. What I'm gonna do moving forward is I'll put a poll on the IFB podcast Twitter to get your votes, and I'll be using that as the community. So it's actually the IFB podcast community, and I'm not leeching on the Fnatic Discord community. So I know some of it cross over, but just to, just to be fair in that sense. But yeah, so for the first day, I think it's pretty straightforward in terms of expectations. Vitality probably gonna come in strong. There's a potential that Mad Lions actually upset on the first game, depending. Rogue, I think, obviously has bit more potential than SK. G2 as well. Misfits Astralis could go either way as well. I'm hopeful that Fnatic beats BDS, obviously for the storyline, but I would, let's say I would not be surprised if BDS wins because they have that built-in synergy already. So, but there's gonna be a lot of tension I think into this game, and if ever on the kill feed there's upset that kills Adam, just just prepare your memes, guys, because I'll be ready on that spot. I'll be taking a screenshot and I'll be posting. So it's gonna be a spicy one for sure. You feel like SK will beat Rogue? I don't know. No, Larson Certus is just too much of a difference in my opinion. But we'll see. Maybe I'm wrong. Day two. So apparently I voted for Misfits. I'm just gonna stand by it. There's probably some logic in here, but yeah, pretty much the same split for the first, oh, in the last game. Yeah, okay, so yes, I did not vote for Fnatic, I'm sorry. I don't know, I'm hoping Fnatic wins, but I'm feeling that Vitality might get it from the start and then we'll beat them on the longer run. I don't know, it's just kind of my gut feeling here. But if they lose, obviously, he can call me a fake fan, if that's important. And finally, final day, reported for toxicity. True. And final day, final day I think is pretty straightforward. I don't know, I feel a lot of people are underestimating BDS. I think they'll play really well on the first week and will beat Misfits. Community voted Misfits. We'll see. I think it'll be very interesting to sort of gauge the level of those players to start, and we'll see where it takes them afterwards. So yeah, that's about it for the prediction, guys, and that's about it for today's podcast. Almost an hour and a half podcast. Jesus, didn't even realize. Hi there, vote Vit. I know. I should be just voting Fnatic every day. That's what this podcast is for in the first place. I don't know. Maybe I'm just a coward on this one. It's possible. But I'm just very anxious about us facing Vitality, because those are the two teams, you know, who are predicted to win it all. So I don't know. We'll see. But guys, super excited for the LEC to start again. Finally, something to live for again. But in any case, thank you for tuning in to this first episode of Season 2 of Inside Fnatic's Brush pre-LEC show. I'll be seeing you next Thursday. Our weekly schedule is back on, so as much as possible, I'll be doing those. Not sure if I'll always do them at 8 p.m. I'll let you know, obviously, in advance. But yeah. Thank you for tuning in, guys. Enjoy LEC. Let's go Fnatic and let's win that trophy. All right, guys. I'll see you next time. Peace.